Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Skeleton Keys, The Unimaginary Friend. Skeleton Keys, Book 1. Written and read by Guy Bass. Skeleton Keys, The Unimaginary Friend.
Greetings to Dally Wanglers, Ring Dingers, and Snuggabouts. To the imaginary and the unimaginary. To the living, the dead, and everyone in between. My name is Keys. Skeleton Keys. Many moons ago, I began my existence as an if, an imaginary friend. Then one day, I suddenly became as real as kneecaps. I had become what we in the business of imagining call unimaginary. But I am more than just a handsome bag of bones. For these fantabulant fingers of mine can open doors to hidden worlds and secret places. Doors to the limitless realm of all the imagination. Old Mr. Keys has seen all that is worth hearing, heard everything there is to see, and forgotten more stories than I shall ever remember. Oh, the things I know would curl your toes. The stories I could tell you. But of course, stories are why you are here. Well, have I got a humdum dinger for you, set to blow your mind out of your nose holes? This unimaginary tale is so truly unbelievable that it must, unbelievably, be true. Meet Ben Bunsen. Now, I know what you were thinking. Why should I care a jot about this little ankle sprout? He may have a head and toes and soul as any person might possess, but he is certainly no dashing, key-fingered skeleton with 1,000 adventures under his belt and 1,000 more to come. To look at him, you might imagine he is unremarkable. And in truth, most people would agree with you. Ben spends his days being ignored by other children. Why? He is not certain. But if he was, he might attempt to do something about it. As it is, Ben has only one friend in all the world. But since this is no ordinary tale, his is no ordinary friend. You see, the most remarkable thing about Ben's friend is that he is a figment of Ben's wild imagination. And strange things can happen when imaginations run wild. Our story begins in a small town on a small island on the second Sunday of February. As mist rolls in over the ocean and the gulls caw in the darkening sky, we see a higgledy-piggledy house. Tall, crooked, and but a stone's throw from a winding beach. It is Ben Bunsen's 10th birthday, and preparations are underway for a party to remember. Chapter 1. A Sea of Balloons. Party time. A little imagination goes a long way. S.K.
How do I look? Ben asked the gorblimey. Since the gorblimey was a figment of his imagination, there was no reply. All the same, Ben waited a moment and then said,
Thanks.
It was the first time Ben had ever had a birthday party. Invitations had been sent to almost every child on Grundy Island. Ben's mum and dad had spent all day getting the house ready. Multicoloured balloons covered every inch of the floor. Bunting hung from the ceiling. Cakes, crisps, biscuits, and a rainbow of fizzy drinks awaited the guests, not to mention gifts and games and an honest-to-goodness firework display in the garden. This was going to be a party to remember.
1 minute to go, he said, checking his watch.
Ben had been in his bedroom in the attic in their higgledy-piggledy house for half an hour. His dad had suggested Ben wait there until everyone arrived and then make a big entrance, accompanied by cheering and party poppers. Ben pressed his ear against the floor, trying in vain to listen for knocks at the door or the bustle of excited guests. The seconds ticked away to 3:30. Party time.
Wish me luck, Ben said. He ruffled his jet black hair, which immediately fell back into its bowl-like shape. Then he straightened his very best jumper, the one with a big stripe which his imaginary friend assured him brought out his eyes, and, with his heart thumping in his chest, he clambered down the ladder from his bedroom to the landing. The spiral staircase was all that stood between him and his first ever birthday party. Ben imagined the faces of his classmates waiting for him to appear. Cliff Pitchfork, the tallest boy in school. Hattie Blanket, with her excellent laugh. Ichabod Twist, who knew magic. They'd all found it easy to ignore him until now. Ben often wondered why he had no friends. For as long as he could remember, Ben's dad had insisted that the family move house every year, relocating from one seaside town to another. Maybe that was the problem. Maybe Ben knew his friendships could not last. Or maybe, he thought, he just wasn't the sort of person that could make friends. Not real ones, at least. But what if this was the day all that changed? What if one of his classmates actually wanted to be his friend? What if they all wanted to be his friend? Ben hardly dared to imagine it, but imagine he did. He swelled with confidence as he made his way down the curling stairs and waded into a sea of balloons. I'm here, he said aloud. Ben stopped. There, in the middle of the room, knee-deep in balloons with party hats perched on their heads, stood his mum and dad, and no one else. For a moment, Ben wondered if everyone was hiding. Perhaps his classmates were crouched behind sofas and chairs or hiding under balloons, ready to jump out and wish him a happy birthday. But then Ben's dad said, I'm so sorry, Benji, but it doesn't look like anyone's going to make it. Ben felt his thumping heart sink into the depths of his chest. No one came, he muttered. I phoned around, said Ben's dad, rubbing the back of his head. But no one answered. I'm sure they would have loved to come, added Ben's mum, trying to sound positive. They're probably just busy. Not for the first time, Ben pushed his feelings deep into the pit of his stomach. And he imagined. It doesn't matter, he said softly. The Gorblimey's here.
Who?
Asked Ben's dad.
Oh, him.
Even though the Gorblimey was imaginary, Ben could picture him quite clearly. He was a sort of monster, hairy, round, and as black as an eclipse, with kind, bright eyes, curved horns, and a yellow-orange candle flame forever flickering in the air just above his head. The Gorblimey was loyal and kind and can shrink to fit in Ben's pocket and bounce right over a house and eat almost anything. And, most importantly, he was always there when Ben needed him.
No, that won't do at all. This is a real party for real people,
Ben's dad continued. He urgently began gathering up balloons, horns, and party poppers.
Come on, let's turn this into a door-to-door party, he declared, stuffing handfuls of biscuits into his pockets. Knock, knock, who's there? Ben's birthday, that's who. We'll take Ben's birthday to every house on the island.
Bob, that's literally the worst idea you've ever had, tutted Ben's mum as Ben's dad blew loudly on a party horn. And it was your idea to move us to this grotty little island.
It's okay, really, said Ben,
desperate to stop the inevitably humiliating door-to-door party before it started.
The Gorblimey's here. We can... No! Ben's dad suddenly interrupted. This isn't a party for imaginary friends. You're 10 now, Ben. You're too old for this sort of nonsense.
Says the man who chooses to spend every free moment alone building a boat out of matchsticks, noted Ben's mum.
It's not a boat, it's a ship. And that's not the point, said Ben's dad. Ben needs real friends.
And one day I'm sure he'll make some, but in the meantime he has his Gorblimey, insisted Ben's mum. What harm can it do?
Look around, snapped Ben's dad. If Ben didn't have imaginary friends, maybe the other children would have wanted to come to his party.
That was too hard for Ben to hear. With tears in his eyes, he ran towards the front door in a flurry of flying balloons. Ben heard his dad cry,
I didn't mean, wait!
But with a slam of a door, Ben was gone. Chapter 2, The Gorblimey, Unimaginable.
An if is the creation of a wild imagination. okay.
Ben ran outside into the cold, damp fog and all the way down to the beach. At the edge of the water, he slumped into the knee-soaking sand and stared out over the sea. Unlike his dad, who could spend hours staring wistfully over any stretch of grey, mist-laden water, Ben hated the ocean. It was so huge that it always made him feel small and alone. So Ben did what he always did when he felt small and alone. He imagined the gorblimey was right there with him. But this time, Ben screwed up his eyes and imagined harder than ever before. You could say he let his imagination run wild. For the first time, he imagined that the gorblimey was real. Ben opened his eyes and found himself still utterly alone. Not even the distant caw of a seagull could be heard. Ben stared at nothing, listened to the faint sound of waves lapping against his knees, and sighed. Then, through the lazy, rolling fog, he noticed a dot of flickering light suddenly appear. It looked like a candle flame, hovering in the air just above the glistening waves. Ben gazed at the light as it moved slowly towards him. He peered closer. There was something in the water, a dark shape just beneath the surface, and it was heading straight for him. Ben froze as the shape rose slowly out of the water. The fog was so thick that he couldn't make out what it was, but it was moving slowly towards him. This thing was alive and as dark as shadows. At first, Ben thought it was a dog or perhaps a person, but there was no way it could be either. Ben held his breath, gazing slowly upwards. The thing loomed over him, peering through large eyes. Ben gasped and slapped his hand over his mouth. "Can't be," he whispered. But it was. It was the gorblimey. The monster was exactly as Ben had imagined him. A plump, hairy thing, just a little taller than Ben and covered from head to toe in sodden fur so black that it seemed to drink any light that touched it. Coiled horns framed round, curious eyes, which almost seemed to glow. The gorblimey let out a gentle chirping sound like a bird, and his candle flame flickered a bright yellow.
"How?"
was all Ben could mutter as he got to his feet. The gorblimey let out a cheerful purr. Ben held out his hand. As ink-black fur enveloped his fingers, Ben laid his palm upon the monster's round belly. It was as warm as an electric blanket, and Ben could feel two hearts beating slowly. The gorblimey was real.
"Where did you come from?"
Ben uttered, not quite able to believe his own eyes. The gorblimey hooted twice. Then he held out a furry finger and pressed it lightly upon Ben's forehead.
"Did I imagine you?"
Ben whispered. The gorblimey nodded, and the flame above his head glowed a warm, happy orange. Without thinking, Ben waved his hand over the flame. It was ice cold. Ben gasped again, and the gorblimey let out a low rumble.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.